you want to measure the effectiveness of some treatment, we have YB is the before. So YB sub T is the treated group before. And the treated group after is YT sub A. So A for after, B for before, T for treatment, treated group. Compare before and after doesn't get a whole lot easier than this. Is something like sales or whatever you're going to be looking at. Less than, greater than, or I guess equal. If they were equal, that would be close to zero or statistically insignificant. So I think I mentioned PG&E to you guys last semester. Most of the stuff we do is like I said, sales. But what PG&E does, what they do is they're not selling us anything. They're not asking us to buy more electricity. They're actually asking us to buy less. Exactly. So their marketing efforts are to get us to be more energy efficient. They want us to adopt more solar panels, they want us to insulate better, they want us to put double pane what are those glass things called?
Windows.
Double pane windows. And new water heaters and all that thing. And they've got a whole bunch of programs, by the way. I don't know if you know this. I know I didn't. But if you're low income, they'll actually do an inspection of your home, and they'll seal your windows. They'll replace your water heater. So if you qualify, you can get all this stuff done for free. The state has mandated them to get us to use less energy. And then there's some low-income programs, but just overall, the state has basically told them you have to get people to use, which is strange. You have to get people to use less energy. So in this case, in the case of PG&E, energy would have to be lower than before. Of course, if it's sales, we want sales greater than before. And again, we want to test for whether or not these things are statistically significant. So PG&E is having a really hard time measuring this stuff. They do energy. They have marketing people, and their marketing people do marketing stuff. They're marketing majors. They're all sharp people, but they're having a really hard time measuring a lot of these programs. A lot of them are mailers that you get in the mail. When you open up your PG&E bill, it'll say your house is using this much energy relative to comparable houses, and mine's like bars like that. You're using twice as much. In the winter, the house is freezing, and in the summer, that we're all sweating in there. I was there. Yeah, in the winter, the house is hot, sweating, we're sweating, and in the summer, we're all freezing. So I didn't use a lot of energy. Then I'm out there hosing down the driveway. It's better than grooming or hosing down. I'm not a good example for this stuff. But they're having a hard time measuring this stuff. So I think it's interesting. I never thought about that. That PG&E is actually trying to get us to use less energy, not more. They're having a hard time measuring this stuff. So obviously they go to the greatest marketing analytics person in the world. So I'm helping them do that stuff. So how do you test for statistically significance? Of course we use our old friend, the regression. Is this fine? Because we're cutting off that side too. Yeah. All right, so we run a regression. And where beta zero is just gonna be the mean sales. Energy use, whatever. Then we define the variable after to be one if it's after the treatment, or we can call it treatment, it doesn't matter what we call it, and zero if it's before the treatment. So now we have a simple before and after where beta zero is the mean before, and beta one is the difference in, or the change in sales or energy usage after the treatment. Okay. So yeah, so before the treatment, after is going to be zero. So this is mean usage before. So beta zero is that YD sub T. After the treatment, after equals one, and beta one represents the difference in our Y value sales or whatever it is after the treatment. So again, if it's positive, sales went up. If it's negative, sales went down. If it's not statistically different than zero, then there was no change in sales. The marketing campaign had no effect. So this is pretty standard stuff. We can do this with our eyes closed. Almost. Okay. Yeah, it's the difference in the means. Beta 1 is literally the difference in the means. And whether or not that's statistically significant and all this, positive or negative. Okay. So now an extension. We're going to add in a control group. So how do you introduce a control group? You can do something called matching, where you try to match a region with another region. Randomization is another way where you randomly sample people and that avoids any biases. And there's something called blocking, which is kind of like the combination of matching and randomization. So if we're matching, we would do something like this. So let's say we got, eight people in here. So so if it was matching, then we'd probably do by gender, right? So we try to, let's say the first group is our treatment group, the second row is our control group, we'd probably match by gender. Guys with guys, girls with girls, something like that. We can do other combinations of stuff. Randomization would be if, okay, we still have this row got the treatment, the second row didn't, but we would take a random sample of people in this row and compare them to a random sample of people in the control, the treatment and control. And the idea is that if it's purely random, again, this is, sample size is too small, but if it's purely random, we're not going to get a disproportionate number of women. You know, this row has a disproportionate share of women. But we would ideally have similar samples between, and randomization would avoid any problems with biases. Matching can be really tricky. It sounds good, but a lot of the times it just, you know, the idea that men are going to behave like other men is just, it can be highly problematic. So you might want to, randomization might actually even be better. Matching sometimes leads to worse results than. Causes more problems than not. Blocking that, like I said, is kind of a combination of the two. But you have to do this beforehand. First thing you do is match. First we say, okay, I'm gonna match the guys with the guys and the girls with the girls. Then I'm gonna flip a coin and randomly select who gets the treatment and who gets the control group. And that's what blocking is. That's ideally the best. Okay, so you expose the treatment to the treatment group, don't expose the control group. For the treatment, you take the mean of y, so y b sub t. Okay, we got that before. After the treatment, you take the mean of y, and you got y a sub t. So we already did this, the treatment group. But now we're going to add the control group and do the exact same thing. Before the treatment that they don't get, we're going to measure something. And then after the treatment that they don't get, we're also going to measure. And basically, we want to compare the relative outcomes. So it's not whether sales or energy usage went down for the treatment group. It's whether sales or energy usage went down for the sales group relative to the control group, the treatment group relative to the control group. So you're looking really at, you're still looking at differences. So here's our before and after for our treatment group. And this is what we did on the previous slide, right? All we did was say, let's compare the after for the treatment group with the before and take the difference. If it's positive, then this is greater than that. If it's negative, then this is greater than that, right? So that's what we did on the previous slide. We're gonna do the same thing for the control group. Now remember, the control group isn't exposed to the treatment. So, theoretically, these two things should be the same. There shouldn't be any change. So this should be statistically insignificant. The problem is that first line. What if there's some factor that caused the treatment group to change that was independent, independent of the treatment? Let's say a growing economy. Right? We got a growing economy, sales were going to grow by themselves anyways. And the only way we can do that is compare it to control group. And that was kind of the sideways effect stuff that we did. So that's why we have this. If sales grew for the control group, which didn't get exposed to the advertisements at the same rate as the treatment group, then the advertisement had no effect at all. And that's what we're going to do in this first problem set. Basically what we're going to do in this first problem set. And essentially we're going to compare, we're going to take the difference of the differences. So we're going to take this difference, compare it to this difference, and this is called the difference in difference methodology. Okay, so how do we do that? Question? How do we do that? We got one Mac. Is that a new Mac or did you have that last semester?
I have a Mac and a PC. Last semester I had a PC with me. Okay. I just didn't bring that today.
Okay. Difference-to-difference methodology developed by some guy named Hartley Ashenfelter in 72, although he just basically stole it from the medical profession. But there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, so how do we implement this? Well, we use regression. So this is that same table there. I just moved it up here. So it's the exact same table. So using regression, we have, we're going to construct, we're going to have three variables. We're going to have treatment, after, and then an interaction of treatment and after. So treatment, one if you're in the treatment group, zero if you're in the control group. After, one if it's after the treatment, and zero if it's before the treatment. And then the interaction. So what do all these regression coefficients, what are they all going to be? Okay, so beta zero, we know, is going to be the mean of the control group before the treatment that they don't get. beta 0 plus beta 1 is going to be the mean of the treatment group before the treatment that they haven't gotten yet. Ideally, you would like beta 1 to be statistically insignificant. And why is that?
What did you say?
Ideally, it would be nice if beta 1 was statistically insignificant. If it was essentially zero.
So it would be a good sample, right?
A good sample in terms of?
They would be the same.
Exactly.
Similar sample.
Exactly. So if beta 1 is statistically insignificant, if it's essentially zero, then what we're saying is whatever is going on with the treatment group is the same as whatever is going on with the control group. They're pretty similar. You don't want them to be different because the whole idea of a control group is to get a similar group to the treatment group. So again, ideally it would be nice if beta 1 is as close to zero as possible. Okay. Beta 0 plus beta 2 is going to be, so beta 2 is after. So it's after the treatment that they don't get. So beta plus beta 2 is the mean of the control group after the treatment that they don't get. If there are no third factors, beta 2 should probably be 0 also. Beta 0, 1, 2, 3, so it's the treatment group, so treatment is 1. It's after, so after is 1. And then it's treatment and after, so both of these are 1. So we're going to get the whole regression in there. And that's going to be the mean of the treatment group after the treatment that they didn't get. Then remember, we take the Berkeley's difference. So the difference between the control group after relative to before is that minus that, and we end up with beta zeros cancel out, we end up with beta 2. The difference in the treatment group after relative to before is beta 2 plus beta 3. So if we didn't have a control group, if beta 3 was statistically different from 0, we would conclude there was some change. Then we're going to compare the difference of the differences. So we subtract it vertically, but then we're going to subtract horizontally. Subtract the treatment group, the difference in the treatment group from the difference in the control group, and we end up with beta 3. And beta 3 is our difference in difference estimator. Is this ringing a bell, is everyone? Yeah. Okay.
Don't change it just yet.
Don't change it just yet.
Well, because I'll remember it better.
So the data set that we're going to look at is pretty cool. It's an internet firm that ran two promotions simultaneously. They ran, this is a national, they ran a radio promotion and an online promotion. And the cool thing, well, radios we can control because we can control those regionally. You run it on certain in certain areas. So we know if you were in that area that you're in the range of that radio station. So that's pretty easy. The internet's a little bit more difficult, but not really anymore. Nowadays, for example, Google has capabilities for you to run ads in those same specific regions. So, and Google actually does, Google actually breaks down the market using the Nielsen market, DMAs, designated market. And these are the same marketing areas that Nielsen uses for television ratings, for sales, the scan data, and all that stuff. And Google will now gives you the capabilities to run an ad, an online ad, for only people in certain areas. Pretty cool. How does it work? I have no idea. I'm sure it has to do with the ISP, or not the ISP, but the your, I guess ISP, is that right? I'm sure it has something to do with that. But they have pretty similar capabilities. They can also track whether or not you're online, so whether someone is exposed to that or not. So we have, so let's go to the data. Really small, simple data set. Time, media type, exposed, and converted. Time represents the time of the day that the radio ad aired. Time of the day that the radio ad aired. And let's see, tab, time. Yeah, looks like it's a really big number because it's the time of the day. So remember how state keeps dates and times. It's the number of days since, well, if it's daily data, it's the number of days since January 1st, 1960. If it's hourly data, which this is, actually this is minute data, this is the number of minutes since January 1st. That's why this is a huge number. So this is a really big number. But we know how to, we can fix that. So it's the number of minutes, and if it was seconds, and so on. Okay. So let's see, let's format. This looks a lot worse than it is. So format time, that's a percent. TC is time clock. Those are capital D's, is the day. Month is month, or MON is month. CCYY is year. And then hours, minutes, and then tell me whether it's AM or PM. We don't want military tech. We're there at 0600 hours or 1600 hours or whatever. We don't want to do that stuff. Let's just stick with times that we can all understand. So this should give us a usable time. So this is just the first 12. You can see that there are four observations for each time, and we'll figure out why. And we're going in, we're not going by the second, we're going by, the time represents the exact time that the radio advertisement aired. And essentially what we're capturing is the 10 minutes before the ad ran and the 10 minutes after. So the ad ran at 12:27, we're going to capture the 10 minutes after that and the 10 minutes before that. So time represents that. And what do we got? So that's the first. This is this is the last 12. So minus 12 tells us the last ones. Let's see. Can you tell the difference between? Okay, so 1 through 12 is telling me, or I'm telling Stata to show me the first 1 through 12 observations. List the first 1 through 12 observations, separated by 4. And then now I'm saying list the last 12. So it's negative 12 through 1, is that right? Does that look like negative 12 through 1? look at this and look at that one up there, or even this one here, this one and that one. Do you see any difference? It's real subtle, and these aren't the best monitors, but that one, that is one. Does it look the same as that one? What's the difference?
The line, it's like flat, the diagonal.
Yeah, line. It goes like that.
I need glasses.
It's the letter L.
It's a small
L for last. So negative 12 tells me, give me the last 12. Negative 12 over L tells me, give me the last 12. Yeah, you would never got that. Even with the HD. The problem is that the difference is so subtle. So in essence, the data goes from, and these are all the symbols. The data goes from essentially midnight on December 15, 2011, roughly midnight, right? 2 minutes before, 10 minutes after. Midnight, December 15th, 2011, to essentially, again, right close to midnight, December 21st, 2011. So it's a week's worth of data. It's only a week's worth of data, so it's not that big of a data set, but it is by a minute. Not every minute, but it's close to that. So I wouldn't answer, right? So we've got roughly seven days worth of data, starting at midnight and then ending again at midnight. And to be specific, midnight, Thursday, December 15th, to midnight, Wednesday, December 21st. Okay, so that's our time. That's our time variable. We're going to use that. How about media type? Let's tab media type. Okay. We have two types of campaigns going. We have the radio advertisements and the online advertisements. So, media type represents, for each observation, it's going to tell us whether or not what each person was exposed to. So, if it's online ads before, it means you were exposed to the online ads. It popped up. It means you were browsing. You were on your computer browsing, but it's before. For what? Before the radio ad. It's before the radio ad. So you haven't heard the radio ad yet. You've been exposed to the online ad, but you haven't heard the radio ad yet. Online ad after. So this is, you've been exposed to the online ad, but you've also heard the radio ad. So you can already see how we've got some, let's see that. And this is the tricky part, is understanding what all this tells us. Okay, so no online ads before. So you haven't been exposed to an online ad, nor have you been exposed to the radio ad. Right? No online ads, but it's after, so you've been exposed to the radio ad. So what is the kind of the pure control group here? Which one is the pure control group? What's that?
No online ad before.
No online ad before. I haven't seen an online ad. I haven't been exposed to a radio ad. If I want to just check the effect of online ads, okay. I've seen the online ad. What do I compare it to? online ad. But also, not just people that haven't seen the online ad, people that haven't seen the online ad, nor
the radio.
The radio ad. So I compare this with this. If I want to compare, and this will tell me the effectiveness, the difference between these two Y's, and we'll see what the Y is going to tell me the effect of the online ad, right? Before and after. If I want to check the effectiveness of the radio ad, what do? No online ad before, no online ad after. So I want to compare these two, right? So neither of these people have been exposed to the online ads, but this person has been exposed to the radio ad, but this person hasn't. Before they've been, this is before. So we really want to answer three questions. Were radio ads effective? Were online ads effective? And was there any synergy? Synergy is one of those, I hate that term. Business school terms, that means you sprinkle some synergy on something and things get better, right? Is that about right? What does synergy mean? Did the two together work are more effective than one's individual? So the synergy would represent, here's no online ads before. So again, this is my pure control group. I haven't been exposed to either media type. And then, which is the synergy one? What do I compare it to?
Online ads.
What's that?
Online ads after.
Online ads after. Yes, I've been exposed to the online ad, and it's after the radio ad, so I've been exposed to the radio ad also. So it's really, that's it. I mean, we're asking, you're being asked to answer three questions. What, was our radio ad effective? Were our online ads effective? And was there any synergy? Should I run them, both more often if there is? And that's really, at the end of the day, that's what we're going to try to measure. Okay, so that is media type. Exposed is literally the number of people exposed to either the online ad, the radio ad, or both. So exposed is, it is a number, it is the number exposed. So it's a number. It's the number of people exposed. So at the minimum, it looks like the smallest number was 231 people exposed. At the maximum, it's 595,000. So there's a nice range in exposures. Number of exposures.
There's got to be a way to correspond this time of day.
Okay. So we know if you've been exposed, but what matters? When all push comes to shove, what matters? Exposures, what do we care about? Your business, what do you care about? What does everything boil down to?
Did that, was it like change?
Changing what?
From hearing that and not hearing that.
Good. What do you want people to do?
Buy.
Conversions. Converted. How many people actually made a purchase? It's an online purchase. And those are converted. So converted is, notice these numbers are a lot smaller, right? So in the end, what we care about is purchase. So this is revenue generated. This is how many people actually went online, made a purchase for this product, which I can't tell you what it is. So, but we know they run radio ads and online ads, and almost nobody does that, right? So yeah, lots of zeros, obviously. And the biggest number is 48, almost 49,000. And that's it, this is all you're given. But we want to ask questions about, I mean, not only are the online ads effective, you asked about time of day of week, those kinds of things. Is there a better time to run the ads and a worse time and all those kinds of things? So this is what marketing analytics is all about, trying to find this optimal mix of, one, is it effective? Maybe not. It's effective some days and sometimes, and not other days and not other times. So, and these ads change. They'll get a new spokesperson. So maybe using who does nobody like right now? Besides me. Maybe using Bill Cosby as a spokesperson wasn't the best idea. Someone like that. OJ's going to be out of jail, so he'll be free to promote that. All right, so first thing we always do is what?
Run a regression.
Yeah, even before we run regressions. Graph the data. We look at graphs. So, we scatter. And not run out of here, but actually look at some scatter. So let's look at the exposed. And this is made up to look nice, but it's just a scatter. Once we've set time once we've set time up, and I changed the colors, so one of the reasons you could tell, or one of the reasons why this is so nice, because this was actually a paid project of mine, so I changed all the colors to look nice. But it's our typical scatter. I changed the colors, but in the end, it's scatter exposed time by median time. So that's, everything else is aesthetics. So the main part you want to look at is, and the rescale is probably important, well, the rescale is aesthetics also. So, but outside of that, everything is, lab size, titles, and all kinds of other stuff. So we look at this, clearly we're seeing something. Remember, this is 7 days, so we're probably seeing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? We're seeing each one of these is a day, so there's clearly some changes throughout the day, as we can see. There's changes, there are some changes throughout the week, would you say? A little bit, yeah. I mean, it seems to be going down. Remember, the week starts on a Thursday, so Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then it ends on Wednesday night again. So, but we'll take a closer look at those questions, and that's going to require a little bit of work also. So, but we see, again, these are exposures to online ads before, online ads after, no online ads after. So, no online ads before. What this means is that people were exposed to other online ads, but not yours. So, again, the power of being able to track people's usage on the internet, I guess when it boils down to it, it's kind of scary. if they don't know it, they can purchase data and. It's not just the cookies, which most of us see. There are firms that, you guys know what beacons are? Beacons, so cookies tell you, kind of when you go to the web page, the cookies tell you where you've been on a particular web page. So when you go to, and sometimes it speeds things up for your, because it knows you're already going there, so it'll load those pages again. But beacons are a little bit different. They don't tell you, what pages you've been on a specific website. They tell you where you've been all day long. So they know that you're coming from, I'm coming from ESPN.com to whatever, stated.com and stuff like that, so they know what my interests are. And that data you can buy from third-party firms. And those beacons are really, really, that data is really powerful.
So does that time of day start at like 4 o'clock in the afternoon somewhere?
So
the print's really small.
Yeah, this first one looks like 4:40 p.m. But that's here.
Yeah.
But we know the data started at midnight on that.
So it just looks like it's looking at drive time.
Yeah, so we're going to take a little bit closer look at that. Because that's a good question also. Well, I guess since you mentioned it, here is one day. So what I did was, I told you we went from December 15th at midnight. So all I did was change this to December 16th at midnight and say, okay, give me the full 24 hours, full day. There is a better way to do this because really what this gives me is one day. It gives me that one day of Thursday night to Friday. So you see kind of some awkwardness here. Now you see this as about 11 a.m. I'm sorry, yeah, 11 a.m. And so on. This really isn't the best way to do this. There's the better way to do this isn't to tell me what happened on any particular day, but to tell me, on average, what happened. So what does the average day look like? Does that make sense? We don't want to, kind of pulling out a day at random is probably going to be representative, but it's better to say, okay, show me what the average day is. So we got 7 days, and let's look at the exposures throughout the day, kind of averaging all seven of those days. So to do that, yeah, we want to know what is the busiest hour of the day. We want to pull out hour from time. So we're going to need to generate that. And that's pretty easy. I don't know why hour doesn't equal hour, but it equals HH. So pull out the hour, I'm going to call it hour, from our time variable. And that should be as you would expect. Hour 0 through 23. Different computer packages do things differently. Sometimes it goes 1 through 24. For example, I think Stata goes 1 through 24. Stata goes 0 through 23. So, no, there's not 23 hours in the day, there's the 0 hour. If you're not sure what the 0 hour is, the midnight hour, as this picket was saying. I think we all love this picket. I love this picket. Okay, so yeah, so you can see 0 hour is midnight, 1 is 1, 2 is 2, that makes sense. It actually makes sense to have 0 hour as midnight, and because then 1 lines up with 1. If the first hour was 1, then 1 would be 2. No, 1 would be 12, 2 would be 1, and that's how I'm already getting confused. So Stata, it makes sense the way Stata does, but I think SAS, like I said, goes 1 through 24. People like that 24. Alright, so the best way to do this, I think, is a bar graph. So again, the main part of the bar graph is, so graph bar mean exposed over hour, and then you're done. So everything after this, so if we put parentheses here, it would work. Everything after that is, again, aesthetics. So what a graph bar is going to show us, the hour by hour usage on average for those 7 days. And I put the graph, where is it? Where's my B label? Oh. B label tells us to put the number on the top of the bar. The numbers are kind of big, so I made them small. This is telling me to not give me any trailing zeros. I don't need to know, there shouldn't be trailing zeros or decimals, but well, there could be because these are averages. So again, this gives us an idea of the usage throughout the day. And it makes sense. We start to hit the sack around noon. These guys are still up playing Xbox or something. I don't know what they're doing. But they're surfing the web, surfing. These are exposures. Right? So they're not on Xbox. You get ads on Xbox. Right? You do?
Not yet.
While you're playing Xbox, you get ads?
No, you don't. Not yet.
You sign in, there's a you play Xbox?
I
my kids play Xbox. I hate that. Or they used to play Xbox. I gave it away. Man, would they make it. Okay, so you're hitting you're getting some sleep here, and then it starts to go up. There doesn't seem to be a whole lot of throughout the 8 to throughout the day, I guess, the waking hours, there doesn't seem to be a whole lot of differences. So once we wake up, this is really what this says. Once we're up at around 9 o'clock, we're pretty consistently online. I guess we got to go to the bathroom around here or something, but so 15 is 3 o'clock. So doing it. Why are we taking a break at 3 o'clock?
Kendall work done.
Getting some work done. To make it look like you're working while your boss is walking around instead of whatever, doing whatever he's doing. Is that surprising? Is this surprising to anyone? Because remember, this is monitoring people exposed, and be exposed, you have to be online. So, but it's basically telling us that our online behavior throughout the day is consistent. But, I mean, once I'm up, I'm checking email and I'm checking to see if there's any injuries, if it's Kaepernick's been deported or something. too much? I'm not a big fan of that either. But I don't know if you're into that kind of stuff. What did I do? It's these three lines here. So I added these three lines. Show Y variables. Show Y bears. As Y bears. And then legend off. So otherwise it would tell us the days. It would give us a legend. And we don't need a legend. We know what one is. It's 1 o'clock in the morning, and so on, and so on, and so on. So that gives us the colors, but as you can tell, it's kind of, as you said, annoying. It's probably good. If you want to make it a little bit nicer, here all I'm doing is labeling the values. One thing nice about this is once you've defined this, copy, you'll reuse this, copy and paste it 100 times over. And let me go back to that first one that was asking me. So now I don't have to worry, I don't have to try to figure out what 1500 hours or whatever is. I know that people are taking a break. Boxes walking by. Okay, so we don't know much about the exposures. The exposures aren't showing a whole lot of interesting stuff. What is the busiest day of the week? So we only have 1 week, so these really aren't going to be averages. These are going to be the actuals. But we still need to kind of pull out that day of the week. And the day of the week is, I'm calling day of the week DOW because it's DOW. And notice you have to do a kind of a function of a function. And when you have time values, you have to do this. So if this was just a regular, for example, Nielsen data, if it was weekly data, or daily data, and we wanted to find out the day of the week, then you wouldn't need this double thing. But because it's time, we have to go through this other, so this is D0, and that's F, and a big C. And that's how we format the data. So this should give us the days of the week.
It's D0 or DO?
I'm sorry, DO, right. Tab. And yeah, so 0 is Sunday. In state is 0 Sunday. And again, that matters. So we put those same labels on there, and we don't have to worry about 0 Mondays. Okay, and then we basically run that same graph. Not run the colorful one. And again, this isn't really an average. These are the actual days. So Sunday and Monday are similar. That's strange. Because Sunday you're not at work. But Monday you are at work, and you're online even more.
Friday makes sense.
Okay, by Tuesday I gotta get some work done.
That's a shit show.
I'm drifting back up. I'm drifting back up towards the end of the week, and by Friday I'm online all day again, getting exposed to ads. So to me this is fun. I wish we had more weeks to see if this pattern holds up, but I suspect it does. I suspect this is probably going to be pretty similar to throughout the...
Well, this is during December, correct?
Yeah. So it could be you're on vacation?
Shopping, no.
Oh, you're shopping?
Shopping and shipping arrives. Yeah. So shopping Monday, shopping Friday. Your stuff comes in Wednesday, your stuff comes in Monday.
But you're at work here. You're supposed to be working here.
Yeah, but it's Christmas time.
Still getting paid. Yeah. So again, this is somewhat interesting. Okay. Exposures. So, and we'll see, we'll kind of look at some stuff, but let's look at conversions. Because conversions is the stuff we're really concerned with. That's the colorful one. All right, conversions, we already kind of summarized conversions. It's a lot smaller. Let's take a look at a time. Yeah, they just scattered it. This turned a relatively simple project. It threw a wrench in things. There's this huge spike. And we need to account for it. So we can't just attack the data as it is. We need to, not that we need to figure out what that spike is, we just need to account for that, the fact that there's a spike there. So it's really hard to see anything. Look at the scale. This is 50,000. that one maxes out at 2,000, 2,000, and again 50,000 there. So, and it's just the scale here is this jumps up, and then it looks like it equilibrates. So we got to do something. Mostly, the first thing we've got to do is figure out when this spike is. So we've been looking maybe before and after the spike, or at least look at the pre-spike period. Now what I did when I did it is I looked at the pre-spike period and the post-spike period to see, okay, there was a spike, but did anything change before relative and after? Because I don't know. We can kind of eyeball this. So this is the 21st of December, 2011. That looks like 350-ish or something. I think it actually looks better on the screen.
Yeah, it's actually better on the screen.
But the easiest way to do that is probably just to kind of manually take a look. So pretty simple, table, time. So by time, show me the conversion rates. Not the conversion rates, the number of conversions. Through the data, and I'm sure I'm sure a programmer would be able to figure out a way to do this easier, but I'm not a programmer. But you can see that we've got, you know, pretty consistent numbers here, pretty low, you know, 80, 50, 60, something like that. I'm just going to scan down. All right, No spikes, nothing special going on.
What do you mean when you're talking about conversions?
Conversions are the number of people that made a purchase. We're able to convert the ad to a
like click through?
A sale, exactly. Again, pretty similar. We're seeing kind of a small decrease here. We're in the 50s, 60s, and it kind of drops down to like 3. But this could be because of time, right? We're talking about in the middle of the day, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. But we know that people might be working or something. I mean, nothing. Remember the size of the spike. Are we looking for a subtle change here? These are all look reasonable. Some kind of spike there. Back in the 60s, 50s. There's some hundreds. That's not, you know, that's not a really huge spike. All right, now this is starting to go very well. Better go back down again. So we go from 187, which is kind of high, but now we're at almost 3,000. Now we're 10,000. So we know when that spike is. That spike occurred roughly 5:22 on December 21st. We're going from getting 187 people that see or are exposed to the radio ad to, I don't know what that magnitude is. That's a lot, 3,000. So that's a huge spike. So there's our spike. So we have a pretty good idea when the spike is. Just to be sure, again, kind of belts and suspenders kind of stuff. And again, I'm being paid for this, so I can afford that. I broke it down by probably shouldn't tell us anything. But I did time and media type. So I wanted to see, and we saw that in the graph, that the spikes were all probably pretty, happened pretty much at the same time. But again, just kind of belts and suspenders, let's see. Same time, and there is some difference, and it doesn't matter what the labels on these, but we know one's radio, no internet, no radio, blah blah blah. But you can see that, you know, roughly the same time, not exactly the same time, but roughly the same time. We said 522 at the earlier. This does double, but then it goes to 1,000 here, so that it's increasing by 10 times here. This goes from 551 to 300. This is a big jump, but this is even bigger. Again, this is big. This is only, you know, 300 to 1,200, so that's not huge. 300 to 9,000, that's pretty big. So we can see that there is a little bit of a difference in timing, but we probably want to pick one. We don't want to have multiple fours and afters. We could probably be good with picking one of these. So in the, when we had them all summed up, all added together, we saw that I think the main kind of jump was 522. So kind of, and again, we don't have to be too exact with this, but we do know that there's a spike and that things change by a significant amount. And we just want to be able to identify that. Okay, so we know when that is. Remember that our times, these are what Stata calls human readable, HRF, human readable format, and that the actual time itself is this huge number. It's the number of minutes since January 1st, 1960. We need to recover that number so we can specify befores and afters. We can use this somewhat, but for example, I'll show you. So I want to convert this back to a number. So I'm going to format time back the way it was before. And then I want to list time for that spike, for that spike period. So give me the time, the unformatted time, and Stata will still know I'm talking about this. So using the time clock, which we formatted the data as TC, give me the number for that, and that number is huge, whatever that is. You copy and paste it. You got to make sure you get all those zeros, otherwise you're going to be way off, right? So for example, if we want to draw X line, right? Like we've done in Stata before. That's what we're going to do. We're going to use that number as the X line. So we know where the number is. Again, it doesn't matter that much, but let's switch it back to that. And that was the original format. Yeah, so we're back to regular. And what I did was, okay, I added an X line, but I don't think you're going to be able to see it here. Yeah, I think the X line is there, but you can't see it because the spike is in the way. But what we do want to do is, for example, look at, so that's converted, is look at the exposed. So we know there was, so what do we know? We know there was a huge change in the number of conversions at about 5:22 on December 21st. We know there was this huge spike. So let's go back to the exposures and see if there's any reason why we might see a huge explosion or spike explosion in those conversions. conversions. So basically, it's the same graph, I just added X on it. The answer is no. So whatever caused that spike, it wasn't you being exposed more to the online ads, or the radio ad, or the combination of the two, or the absence of the two, because we don't really see any change in behavior across any of our media type categories for exposures. So this is strange. This is just, and by the way, I'm not making this stuff up. This is the data. So I think it was throwing them off. And it's not throwing us off. We're just, but it's another question. It's another issue. Nothing works out. Fixing one thing, you need to break another thing, and or find another problem, all those kinds of things. So, some kind of problems here. What we'll probably do is, and it makes sense, but what we'll probably do is look at a pre-spike and a post-spike. Let's look at this, let's look at that. I just hate to combine those two together. Now, in all honesty, the whole point of the difference in difference methodology of the treatment and control group is to be able to account for some thing, some other factor that we didn't account for. So remember, we're not holding everything constant, and as long as we as long as that spike affects our treatment group as well as our control group, it should be differenced out. So theoretically, it shouldn't make that much of a difference. And this was actually what the firm was telling me. And he said, well, did it affect the treatment group the same as the control group? And I said, yes. He said, well, then it should have been different. I mean, that's actually, it's a pretty insightful thing for someone to say. I mean, they had their own analytics people, so they were pretty sharp. And I said, yeah, it should, but we're not talking about kind of a subtle difference. We're talking about this gigantic spike. And the problem was, in my opinion, I just didn't like it. So the problem is, when you do a difference in difference, it's going to find the average number of conversions. So it's going to be somewhere around here. Right? This is not representative of this, nor is it representative of this. So if we were to do a difference in difference, we get an average number here. And it would make it, it would make it look like we had more conversions than we actually did. Because the true value is something really, really small, pre-spike, but something a lot greater post-spike. So your conclusions would be right on whether or not the ads were effective, but your numbers would be way off. They would be totally skewed and thrown off by this spike. So let's say that the ad had an effect, had an increased conversions by, let's say something good, 25%, 10%, right? That's huge. Let's say 10%. Increased conversions by 10%. We're talking about very different 10%. Are we talking about 10% of a tiny, tiny fraction? So if we're converting 0.025 or 2.5%, our ad increased by 10%. It's a small number, right? Versus, this conversion rate, let's say, is 12%, and then we're increasing 10% of that. So that's still 10%, but the numbers are going to be way up. Does that make sense? So, yeah, I can't see doing getting that average. It's just, it's so different in the, because of the spike. It throws things off, but also adds more work to us. Use specific design. Okay. Let's look at logs and analytics. What we want to look at is not necessarily the conversion, number of conversions, but the conversion rate. Right? Because if you got more conversions, but you have more exposures, then the ads aren't any more or less effective.
Double equals or single?
It's a single. This is what we're going to look at anyways. Again, lots of zeros. And it's multiplied by 100, so these are already percentages. So this is, half a percent. This is 13%. So at our highest, we're only converting 13%, almost 14%. Of our advertising. If you look at, again, these are the way Stata does this. This is nice, but these are the four highest values in the data set. If you think about percentiles are nice because they give you kind of a better representation of what the conversion rates look like. 99% of the time, conversion rates were 8% or less. 95% there, but look at the drop-off. 95%, they're 7% of those. 90%, they're under 1%. So most of the time, 90% of the time, we're converting less than 1% of our advertisements online, radio, and then again the combination. But remember, these are somewhat misleading too, because we really got two ranges of values. We got that pre-spike period, which is really low, and then we got that post-spike period, which is a lot higher. So we'll look at those. Any questions? Any questions on what we're doing? Again. Final questions are online advertising effective? Are our radio ads effective? And again, is there any synergy? The kind of questions we talked about, you mentioned earlier, was time of day of week. Those are excellent questions, but when we looked at the data, we don't know either. So we didn't see a whole lot of variation throughout the day, other than, that 3 o'clock in the morning, whenever that was.
Would we be able to figure out why that spike occurred if we knew what the product was? Would it be like, oh, duh, immediate?
Like Tylenol or something like that?
Well, just given the time of the year that is, if it was
perhaps
people are shopping for.
Yeah, perhaps. So we know it's an online product, or you can purchase it online, and they're doing it online. Okay, so let's look at the conversion rates. Conversion rates are really what we care about. We kind of see that same issue. that conversion rate, so it's converged, that numerator is, you know, it's just throwing everything off. So it's hard to see anything. We do see that conversion rates, you know, the max is almost 14%, and that's looks like what we're seeing at these spikes here and here. But they hover down to roughly, I don't know, what is that, 7% here? Right? 7, 8, something like that. Looks like it hovers to 8%. We're talking about 8% for the post-spike period. But what are we talking about the pre-spike? We're talking just almost nothing. Well, this is almost nothing because there was nothing. They weren't seeing any ads. But even for, who's seeing both of them? Always online ads after. So even for people that are seeing both, we're still talking about almost nothing. We get some noise here, then we get the spike. So something was anticipating that spike a bit, whatever is going on in the market. We get a new spokesperson, maybe it's
Black Friday.
Yeah, it could be that. Could very well be something like that. Man, we'll have to investigate that. All right, so let's go, we'll do pre-spike and post-spike also. Let's tab. Oh, by the way, I don't even think I mentioned this, but these are coded values, so if we do, this no lab. These are coded values, meaning that they're actually numbers, and I put labels on top of them. So no lab says don't show me the labels. So we want to look at these things. We want to look at the before. We want to look at these individually, so we need to be able to specify them to see if what's going on. Okay, so before we run any regressions, we're just going to kind of eyeball this stuff, even though it's all screwed up because of it. So this is no, this is online ads versus no online ads. I'll show you the do file in a second. Let's see what we're trying to look at. Again, it's hard to see. Well, these are conversion rates. So this is blue. Is that blue?
Yeah.
So blue is the conversion rate of those that saw online ads only. And red is the conversion rate for people that saw no online ads. Or radio ads. No online or radio ads. So in essence, in a difference in difference, right? This is our treatment group. This is our control group. Do we see a difference in the conversion rates? It's hard to tell because the scale is so screwed up. But I mean, those that saw online ads were, it is above. We need to measure to see if that's statistically significant. Boom, we get some noise here. I guess this is, we need to split the data, and we will in a second. Actually, we should split it up now. But it does look somewhat promising for the online ads. It looks like online ads had some effect. Okay, so how did I do this? I don't know. So basically, I did a two-way scatter. So remember what the two-way does is put one scatter on another. So two-way, and then scatter y, x, which would be conversion rate in time, and then scatter z and x, which would be So these are two different. So these are people. So what is this? This is people that saw. People that were exposed to the online ads, but not the radio ads. Before, people exposed to the online ads, but not the radio ads after. People exposed to the online ads, but not the radio ads. Something like that. So how do I do that? So if, where's my media types? Okay, so if, so this first one is, if media, excuse me, if media type equals one. What is one? One is online ads before the radio ad. So I've been exposed to the online ad, but I haven't been exposed to the radio ad. That's the first scatter. So there's an if in there. The second is media type three, which is no online ads, but before the radio ad. So I haven't been exposed to the online ad, nor have I been exposed to the radio ad. So that's the true 0-0. I haven't seen anything. I haven't seen or heard anything. And then all the rest is just kind of making it look nice. It doesn't look nice because I'm gonna dress about it. Okay, so this is kind of looking at the effect of online ads by themselves. And we need to do this for radio ads too. So radio versus no radio. Tougher sell. Again, the scale throws things off, but it's a tougher sell. These suckers look like they're right on top of each other. I mean, you can barely see the blue at all, right? So we saw some separation between online and no online. We're not seeing a whole lot of separation between radio and no radio. Again, neither one of them has been exposed to online. And again, what we would have done is just specify media type 3, it's up there, and the media type 4 is our nothing, right? So 3 is no online ads before the radio, 4 is no online ads after the radio. So before radio, after radio. So exposure control, treatment. Alright. Synergy. So this is online ads, been exposed to online ads, but no radio ads, and red is you've been exposed to online ads with radio ads. So blue is online but no radio, red is both. And it doesn't appear to be much of a difference.
Not so much.
What's that?
Not so much. Tough stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we'll kind of, like I said, we'll break it down in the pre and the post bike, but it's not looking like that.
Those are one and two, right?
And those are. Okay, so we got the visuals. Again, to give the client the numbers and the statistical significance and all that stuff, we need to back that up with the numbers. So we need to back the visuals up with the numbers. So we're gonna do a difference in numbers. So remember the difference in difference. We need a treatment, we need a control, and then some sort of interaction in there that goes in there. But again, this is a little bit awkward because we have two different kinds of treatments. Actually, three different kinds of treatments, right? We've got radio only, we've got internet only, and then we've got the combined two. So, okay. So let's generate a treatment group. I'm gonna create a variable that indicates that you saw an online ad as online ads. So I get paid $3 right now. My creativity. And again, if I saw the online ad, I could be either what? What did I do? So if you saw the online ad, you can be what? Either one or two, right? So less than or equal to two, which would be just one or two. And greater than two means I haven't seen online ads. So no online ads. So one and two have seen online ads. So online ads equals one if I'm either one or two. Got it? All right. Have I been exposed to the radio? What tells me I've been exposed to the radio?
The after.
So after tells me I've been exposed to the radio. If I've heard the radio ad, it's online after and no online ad. Right? So that's going to be either two or three. So that's what we have up there. If I've been exposed to the radio, it's going to be two, media type equals two, or media type four. Did I say two or three? I meant two. Remember, or is that vertical slash, which is above the enter, except for maybe a Mac. Which is control Apple. Backflip. Okay. And I haven't been exposed to the radio ad if it's before. So before is going to be 1 and 3. So before is 1 and 3. Then I want to generate an interaction. Generate online radio means I've seen both the online ad and, excuse me, I've heard the radio ad. This is our synergy verb. Is there any synergy between the two? It's different than when we looked at the pure difference in difference. When we had just one before, one after, one treatment, one control. Now, we've, like I said, we've got three treatments, so it's a little bit different. and it's going to require a little bit more work interpreting the coefficients, but it's all still doable. Fit is horrible because of the spike. The spike's screwing everything up. Let's try to figure out what all this means. So let's call this conversion rate. Beta 1 is online. Beta 2, X2 is radio. Plus beta 3 is online and radio. Plus our air. So if all these are zero, beta zero represents what?
Conversion.
What?
Conversion rate.
Of who?
People not exposed.
To?
Eagle.
Any, exactly.
So that's group three.
Yeah. Exposed to either. Yeah. So this is the mean conversion rate of people not exposed to either the radio ad or the online ad. Beta 1 is coefficient on online ads. Here's online ads. So,
seeing the ad that haven't heard the radio yet?
Yeah, so it's, well, it's online, so online includes both, right? Online includes those that have been exposed to the radio and, right? Because it says online, it doesn't say no radio, it just says online. So they've been exposed to online, so. Online with and without radio exposure. Let's go back 1 second. Here it is. Okay. So when we generate it online, it equals, it's less than 2, so it's 1, it's less than or equal to 2. So it's 1 and 2, right? Yeah. So online ads before, which means I've been exposed to online ads, but no radio. But it's also 2, which is online ads after, which means I've been exposed to online ads and I've also heard the radio ad. Right? We got that. Two is radio. So this is juxtaposed to radio, but it doesn't have any qualifiers, right? So
within, without?
Within, without radio, right? I'm sorry,
online.
Within, without
online.
Online. Constant, not exposed to either. And beta 1, which is exposed to online ads with and without radio. Are radio ads effective? So we're going to add beta 0 and beta 2. Online, radio, and interaction. Alright, so we can do the math, but in the end, what does it look like? I mean, what would you tell me just from looking at it? Radio ads effective, for example. Coefficient's positive.
No.
It's positive, though.
Yeah.
But it's
less than 2.
It's statistically insignificant, yeah. So it's not different from 0. Online ads is positive, and it's significant. And is there synergy if you saw both? Did you respond better? And does it look like there's much synergy? So seeing, being exposed to both isn't better than being exposed to one. So it appears at least somewhat that online ads might be effective. But we know we're all screwed up by the spike. And I still think the spike is a problem. Okay, so we're going to talk about the spike. Here's the other stuff. That stuff. So let's just go back to. This is pretty simple. I just added an if statement. So we decided on 5/22, December 21st. Okay, so let's call that our pre-spike period. So let's just cut back the data there. Whether it's, we could have used a different date, but let's see. Okay, so what we saw before was horrible. What we saw before was horrible. We saw hovering at zero, and it kind of went up and did that. I mean, we really couldn't see much of anything. But here, at least we see something. We see some variation. It's still, for the most part, here, for the most part, below zero, and we get some spikes here. Here, for the most part, I'm sorry, below 1%. Again, 1% here, maybe a little bit more. Similarly here and there. So clearly there was something going on. And here's the strange part. This is awkward. There's no trend, so to speak. So we're not seeing. And we talked about trend analysis, and we did trend analysis. We're not seeing we're not seeing any trend. What we're seeing is really just a change. We're seeing kind of behavior here, and then it changes to behavior here, and then you change it to another spike. So there's really almost three, or maybe you can even say four different periods. One, two, the spike was one, but remember it kind of comes down a bit, that's four. So we're not gonna do all those, but it's just strange that we're seeing differences here. And we might want to figure out what this is. Is it getting close to the Black Fridays? And it's still December, so it's not Black Fridays after Thanksgiving. Is that right?
Another hurricane
December. Yes, Cyber
Monday,
Tucker Monday and like all those things. So this was 2011, so it's not like it was prehistoric. But what I may want to do is this. Pre-spike. This is different, isn't it? What we saw, kind of saw similar for Sunday and Monday, and it fell. And I guess I don't know.
Tuesday was the lowest before.
Yeah. So it is a little bit different. How about time of the day? And Yeah, that looks pretty much the same as before. We should do this with conversion rates also. I think I left that as an exercise. But to see, just to see if there's any difference in pre and post bike. But it looks pretty similar. Spike is perplexing, right? For Lisa. Okay. So the same, those same graphs, except now we're just cutting to pre-spike. Again, this is online ads, no online ads. So pre-spike, we can see the separation better. Still, you know, look at the axis, this is still 1%, so this is 0.5% here. So we're talking about pretty small effect here. But there is some separation. Being exposed to an online ad is better than not being exposed to an online ad. And we're seeing it, the effect of the online ads are increasing as we get further into that, further towards the spike. So again, conclusion would be, it appears, and we'll run the regression, it appears online ads may have some effect. But I'm still wondering if those are even statistically significant. Remember, we're looking at a tiny scale of less than 0.5%. So this is what, 0.025%? And we're seeing a difference here. Is that difference even statistically significant? Are these numbers so small that they're going to make a difference? And again, online ads cost money, so we want to be able to see if we're getting our money spent, a return on our money spent. Good picture, though. Really cool picture. Again, we're back with questions. All right, radio, no radio.
Well,
this is tough. yeah, we're just not seeing anything for the radio. We're seeing a change. But the treatment and control group are moving together. So, yeah, it's hard to say radio ads have any effect at all. I assume radio ads are expensive. They're not free, I know that. This looks worse than online ads by themselves. Right? Online ads No radio ads versus online ads with radio ads. The online ads by themselves looked like a better, like there was a better return. But adding radio ads to online ads, it doesn't appear to have much of an effect. So 2011, where do you listen to radio anyways? At home?
In the car.
Yeah, you don't listen to the radio. Does anyone listen to the radio at home?
No.
Yeah, so you listen to the radio at home, I mean in the car. And remember, we're only measuring 10 minutes before the ad, 10 minutes after the ad. How often do you, oh, that sounds like a pretty cool product. I'm gonna go run into the website and go make a purchase.
While
I'm driving. Yeah, or while I'm driving, you're on your phone. I guess you can do this on the phone too now. So, especially for an online product that you have to buy online. So remember, the conversion is an online conversion. So this almost falls into the duh category. It's hard to sell stuff on the internet in a car. Your ads are, it's a tough sell. So, the marketing people had a different opinion of that because they didn't like my results. But and again, these aren't even analytic results. These are just graphs. These are just, you know, hey, you tell me what the conversion rate between these two looks like. Why they couldn't construct these graphs themselves was kind of a surprise. But yeah, there's not a whole lot of PhD level analytics going on here. This is just a simple graph. We're not seeing much. Okay. Something happened. We don't know what it was, but something happened. Oops. So post by conversions. It's a much shorter period, but we do see conversions instead of being whatever 1% or less. You know, we're talking about maybe 7 or 8%, 7 or 8% across all four. So where are no online ads after? So where are no online ads before? Yeah, what do you notice? Yeah. I've seen nothing online and I haven't heard a radio ad, but my conversion rate is higher, irrespective. So again, it's kind of hard to, from this graph, it's kind of hard to say that there was any marketing effects. So clearly something happened with that spike. Huge. What's that? Yeah, the price change, that's kind of always, I'm always going to fall back on price. So I'm not sure what this is. This is the same graph. Oh, this is just has our predictor. All right, so let's go back to online versus no online. The pre-spike actually looked a little bit better, didn't it? Because the blue was consistently, right? The blue was consistently above the red. But now you've got the red is much above the blue as the blue is above the red, if not, you know, more or so. So clearly conversions went up, but at least in terms of online advertising, marketing effectiveness appears to have gone down, if there was any effect at all to begin with. So you've got, again, this is why we looked at the pre-spike and post-spike. This is why we don't average the two. You got those two things happening. Conversion rates went up, but marketing effect went down, if there was any at all to begin with. know, we didn't see much, we weren't much impressed much with radio to begin with. We haven't changed our opinion yet of this. So this is radio. And again, this is three verses four. So this was radio. Yeah, both, neither online, neither of them seems to be exposed to online ads. Here's our synergy. I see red on top of blue, I see blue on top of red. I see no synergistic effect of radio and online All right, I wasn't going to do, I was just going to show you something about results. Thank you. questions on, any questions, what we did? The one thing that I want to make sure you guys do is outreg stuff. So don't not outreg. You know how much I hated that.
Well, you think it's
how much the grader hated that. So, are you using Outreg or Outreg 2?
Outreg 2.
Outreg 2? Okay. Okay, so Outreg 2, yeah, this should be sufficient. Why do I have different, these are just appends. So we got all this down, you gotta specify where you're gonna put it, the drive, the folder, name the file it's going to create. Specify Excel, specify bracket, specify adjusted R squared, and you don't put append on the first one. I'm sorry. You don't put append on the first one. But if you're adding regressions like we have today, we're going to use the append because we're going to have. What are we going to have? We're going to have three regressions, right? We're going to have a regression for the total sample, a regression for the pre-spike, and a regression for the post-spike. So instead of having three of those big, ugly, nasty regressions, the outreg just puts them in a nice table of regression outputs, regression results, and all that works nice. Remember the whole asterisk thing is only relevant if we want to use, if we want to access the regression results, right? So if we're using our regression results to construct some variable, then you want to put on outreg 2. Is it no asterisk on outreg 2? Mm-hmm. Yeah, no asterisk, probably. And on outreg puts the asterisks on the t-stats or the p-values. So that's the only reason I like outreg versus outreg 2. That it puts the asterisks on the t-stat, which we don't use anyways, instead of the coefficient, which we do use. Other than that,
it's crazy in here.
It was hot today, wasn't it?
Yes.
How hot was it here? I really didn't go outside today.
It's 105 in the office.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's 102 in
Glen
Allen.
It's like 95 here.
Yeah, I'm actually 102 in Glen Allen.
Jesus.
I smelled something 80 when we got here. It's cool.
Yeah, it's so good.
Interesting.
Is that
the
open tonight?
Yeah. Interesting project, or?
Yeah.
It's a really cool project. It was a shock, I think, to the firm that they're kind of give away the results, but their marketing efforts, even the pre and post spike stuff, were bad because I don't think anything comes out significant. If I remember correctly, I don't think anything comes out significant. So
they weren't able to account for the spike?
No, they know what the spike is. They know what the spike is.
Is there like product in the news or something?
It was something like that. But it's good. I mean, it's good because the spike is conversion rates went up. Yeah, increased sales. But it even lessened the effect of the only partially effective marketing campaign, which was their online ads. Radio was just absolutely useless. I don't know. I mean, this isn't my job anyways, but so I don't know if they should. If you're looking at radio and most people listening to the radio in the car, 10 minutes isn't enough to get home and buy something. Even if you did remember an ad, perhaps you need a longer time frame rather than 10 minutes. No? Not gonna make a difference? So yeah, I don't know. Those are marketing people. But that's something that they might have considered. It's something I mentioned. It just said, maybe 10 minutes is